We finally detected X-rays from Uranus. Oh, you're a professional, Becky. Come on. In all seriousness, though, this is a big deal. We know so little about Uranus, which is one of the weirdest planets in the solar system, spinning completely on its side. And detecting X-rays from it might just give us an insight into this, the most mysterious planet in the solar system. Now, we've detected X-rays from all over the solar system, from comets and asteroids, Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, some of Jupiter's moons, and even tiny Pluto. That's not as weird as you might initially think, because most of those objects are just reflecting the sun's light back at us. You know, in the same way that trees and mountains and us, we don't emit light, but we can still see those things because we reflect other sources of light, like the sun's light, for example. But the sun doesn't just emit in optical light, visible light that we can see, it emits across the entirety of the electromagnetic spectrum, the full spectrum of light. Anything from radio waves to ultraviolet, which is what gives us sunburn, and also X-rays, which thankfully for us are blocked by the Earth's atmosphere. No, you know, potentially damaging or dangerous X-rays make it down to the surface. They're reflected back out into space, which means the Earth is also giving off an X-ray signal because it's reflecting the sun's X-ray light back out into space. And so you'd be able to see it in X-rays. Now, it's great news for us that the Earth's atmosphere blocks X-rays. It's not so great news if you're an X-ray astronomer and you want to view the sky using X-rays, because it means you can't do it with a telescope from the ground. You have to launch a satellite or a telescope into space to be able to do this. And that way, using that telescope, you can detect anything from the X-ray light from the sun to the X-rays reflected by planets. For example, Jupiter's aurora, its northern and southern lights, give off X-rays. This is caused by high-energy particles which stream off the sun, interacting with Jupiter's magnetic field, and they give off this high-energy X-ray radiation. The same thing actually happens with Earth's magnetic field as well, just to a lesser extent because the magnetic field's a bit weaker. Now, we know a lot about Jupiter, and that's because we've sent so many probes and missions there previously. So, for example, the Voyager probes flew past in the 80s, Cassini flew past Jupiter on its way to Saturn, and then also New Horizons flew past Jupiter on its way to Pluto. But also because the Galileo mission spent 7 years in orbit around Jupiter in the late 90s, and then also we've currently got NASA's Juno probe in orbit around Jupiter right now, sending back, honestly, some of the most drool-worthy images that I have ever seen. But it's a very different story for Uranus. The only mission to come anywhere close to Uranus was Voyager 2 in 1986. And there are no future missions planned to Uranus either. Now, while the data collected from Voyager 2 taught us a lot, like what makes up the atmosphere of Uranus, what the weather's like in it, it also discovered 10 more moons on top of the 5 that we already knew, and it studied Uranus's rings, finding 2 new ones, plus it studied Uranus's magnetic field, which was one of the weirdest results to come out of the flyby of Voyager, because it showed that the magnetic field of Uranus isn't actually lined up with the planet. It doesn't pass through the center of Uranus. And that could be something to do with the fact that Uranus spins on its side as it orbits the sun. So if you think about sort of the solar system, you've got the sun spinning on its axis, and that's what we define as sort of like solar system north, if you will. And then you've got all the planets orbiting in a roughly flat plane that's perpendicular to that. So a perfectly aligned system would be a planet that's essentially orbiting the same angle as the sun, right? But Uranus doesn't. It orbits on its side at about 97 degrees from the sun's north. So Uranus is essentially rolling on its side as it orbits the sun. And this is what makes it such an interesting system to study, because it's nothing like what we have on Earth or Saturn or Jupiter that we've studied so intently. You actually have a magnetic field that is directly pointing at the sun and pointing at all those high energy particles that are streaming off it as well. So it makes for a really complex system. Now, Voyager detected aurora on Uranus during its flyby in 1986, and astronomers using the UV detectors on the Hubble Space Telescope also spotted aurora back in 2012. So there could also be X-rays coming from the aurora and the magnetic field around Uranus as well, but we never detected it. And we've also never detected the amount of X-rays you'd expect from just Uranus reflecting back the sun's light, you know, from the size of it and from how reflective Uranus should be. That's not for lack of trying. People tried in the 90s with an X-ray telescope called ROSAT, but couldn't detect anything above what we call the background noise of X-rays. You know, just kind of like the general background of X-rays that's just sort of floating around the universe, you know, that sort of overpowered the signal from Uranus, at least with this telescope with ROSAT. However, a study came out this year by Dunn and collaborators who claimed that they'd finally detected X-rays from Uranus using data from the Chandra X-ray telescope. And this was data that they'd actually managed to grab that had been taken in 2017 and also way back in the archive from 2002 when Uranus just sort of happened to be in shot when it was observing something else. Now, this data that they have is not pretty. I'll warn you now. Here it is, the three observations, one in 2002, two in 2017. Every blue dot you can see here is a particle of X-ray light that has hit the detector. The red circle is where Uranus is. So you can see the observation from 2002 that most of the X-ray emission detected came from that red circle. It came from Uranus. The 2017 observations are a little bit different, and that's because they have come from a different detector on the Chandra X-ray telescope, which is much more sensitive, not just to the high energy X-rays that you'd expect planets and planet auroras to be giving off, but also the lower energy X-rays as well that make up a little bit more of the background noise. So you can see that really clearly here, right? There's a lot more X-rays detected in the background, outside of where Uranus is on the detectors. So a lot of work goes into figuring out if there's statistically more X-rays been detected in that red circle where Uranus is than you'd expect given the average background noise in the rest of the image. Now, in the observation from 11th of November in 2017, there's apparently not, according to the authors. But a day later, on the 12th of November 2017, there is statistically more X-rays in that red circle where Uranus is than you'd expect from the background that you detect elsewhere in the image. And you can kind of see that by eye too, just by comparing those two observations. And that's really interesting that those two observations that are only a day apart are so, so different. It suggests that the X-rays that are coming from Uranus aren't like intrinsic to a property of the planet. So they're not like constant, like you would expect from the sort of constant reflection of the sun's light backwards. But they could be from something like an aurora, which is changeable day to day, right? It's the same thing we see on Earth. It's dependent on how many high energy particles are burped up by the sun. And in fact, when Dunn and collaborators actually did the calculation of, okay, how many X-rays have we detected, and is it more than you would expect from just the general reflection of light from the sun, they found that it was, suggesting there was some extra process going on here, which is very exciting. But it can't actually be pinned down on the aurora of Uranus just yet, because it actually could be something else that's producing the X-rays, like, for example, Uranus's rings. In the same way that we've actually detected X-rays from Saturn's rings as well. Figuring out, though, whether it's the aurora or the rings or something else on Uranus that's producing these X-rays is going to be really difficult, and it's not something you can really do with this Chandra data that they've been working with here. You need a much better location for where the X-rays have come from. You need a higher resolution telescope. The best thing you can do at the minute is essentially compare what the Hubble Space Telescope observed of the aurora at the exact same time as the X-ray observation that you made. But you can see it's not really precise enough to make any firm conclusions about whether the X-rays are actually coming from the aurora or not. So the paper describing the study ends in pretty much the same way as most astrophysics papers do, just by saying we need more data, essentially. And that could either come again from the Chandra telescope by perhaps looking at Uranus again with a longer exposure time. This time so looking for longer and recording what they see for longer. And that'll help you collect more signal from Uranus as opposed to just the general background noise. Plus an extra observation would essentially give you like another data point, right? To work out if the amount of X-rays you get from Uranus really is that changeable, right? And just working out if the 11th of November observation or the 12th of November observation were just like random flukes instead. But with Chandra, you're still not going to get the location data you need to pinpoint whether it's coming from the aurora or from the rings, just because that telescope is limited by the resolution it has. But ESA are planning to launch a new X-ray telescope called Athena in 2031. So it's a bit of a wait away, but that will have a much better resolution and you should be able to pinpoint where the X-rays from Uranus are coming from. Or perhaps the people who study these ice giants of the solar system, Uranus and Neptune, they might finally actually get a mission to either one or both of these planets in the same way that we've sent Cassini to Saturn, Juno to Jupiter, and even New Horizons to Pluto. Think about how much more we learn about all of those planets by doing that. That's what they're hoping for with Uranus and Neptune some point in the distant future, and then hopefully that'll help to dispel some of the mystery around Uranus, one of the weirdest planets in the solar system. Before we get to the bloopers, I just want to say a big thank you to this week's video sponsor, Brilliant. I love partnering with Brilliant because it gives you lot an opportunity to learn something new. Brilliant is a website and an app that gets you to learn by doing. My personal favorite way of learning something. It's got interactive courses that get you to solve problems in real time, and it has something for everybody. Whether you want to start at the basics with the foundations of physics or maths or computer science, or you want to dive into cutting edge topics like cryptocurrency or machine learning. I think their astrophysics course is particularly impressive. Again, it starts at the basics, but it also goes into more detail with some of the later courses too. This course is an introduction to radiation in all of its forms. If you want to understand a bit more about X-rays and the spectrum of light after watching this video. So if that sounds like something that you'd be up for and you want to support me and my channel, head to brilliant.org/Dr. Becky, that's D-R-B-E-C-K-Y, and sign up completely for free. Plus, the first 200 people that go to that link that's in the video description down below will get 20% off an annual premium subscription. So thank you so much to Brilliant for continuing to support this channel and also for providing people with an opportunity to learn something new as well. And now, let's roll those bloopers. Oh, so hungry. Come on. Nothing like lunch to motivate you not to. Now, we know a lot about Jupiter because we've sent a lot of probes or missions to Jupiter in the past. So, for example, the Voyager probes that flew plastic. Actually turned out to be sort of the weirdest result that came out of that flypie. It's like it's a Python package. Flypie. Import flypie. But it's a very different story for Uranus, the only probe to ever head anywhere. Probe, I really can't say the word probe when I'm talking about Uranus, can I? Oh, my inner child needs squishing. As well, so maybe we'll sort of start, you know, like just scratching the surface, you know, of the mystery of Uranus. I can't say it's scratching the surface of the mystery of Uranus. Oh my God. Think before you speak. No probes, no scratching, nothing like that.